Today on Playmakers, we have the tournament results from the KU women's golf and rowing teams. With basketball season right around the corner, we take you behind the scenes for some of this year's preparations. And this weekend, the football team heads up to Manhattan for the highly anticipated Sunflower Showdown. I'm your host, Emma Hale, and welcome back to Playmakers. Some big news out of KU Volleyball. Senior Aya Elnadi had her 1,000th career kill in Wednesday night's game against Iowa State. Her teammate, senior Cameron Turner, also hit a milestone as she had her 1,000th career dig. Big things on tap for the Jayhawks as they host 21st-ranked Utah on Saturday. Staying with KU sports, we have big news from the water and the green. Emily has the latest on the women's rowing and golf teams as they took home some extra hardware over the weekend.
Thanks, Emma. We've had some powerhouse female athletes this past week. First, let's take a look at the rowing squad. The women's rowers traveled all the way to Cambridge, Massachusetts to compete in the head of the Charles Regatta, and boy, did they sweep. The Club 4, one of two Kansas boats entered in the world's largest three-day regatta, took home a first-place finish in a race with over 50 boats. The boat consisted of three seniors, Ava Black, Sarah Sutton, and Carly Larson, one junior, our own Kara Lyons, and sophomore Gracie Shepherd. Their final time was 18 minutes and 20 seconds. To put it into perspective, this regatta had over 11,000 rowers featuring Olympians and elite college athletes. So we are beyond proud of you and your team, Kara. Let's take a look at this special moment too. Jayhawk Jamboree here in Lawrence on November 3rd. While we're talking about wins, the women's golf team won the White Sands Bahamas Fall Invitational. The Jayhawks finished the tournament as the only team under par on the last day and jumped up three spots on the leaderboard to secure their final win. Their final team score was 587 and made up for an 11-stroke deficit in the final round. Senior Lily Hurst tied for fourth place, finishing two under par and had five birdies in the final round. The next finisher tied for seventh was sophomore Lila Lauerbaugh, who was four above par in the final and marked her first career finish in the top 10 for the Jayhawks. After successfully winning three of four fall tournaments they competed in, we will see the team next year when they compete in Arizona on January 27th. It feels great to be a Jayhawk after this week of tournament wins. Emma, I'll swing it back over to you.
Congratulations to both teams. Earlier this week, Chad sat down with seven-time Conference Coach of the Year, Lindsey Kuhl. Kuhl is entering her fourth season as the head women's golf coach and is looking forward to what the remainder of this season holds. Let's watch.
As the Kansas women's golf team prepared to tee off at the White Sands Bahamas Fall Invitational, prospects of winning a third straight tournament for the first time in program history began to materialize. History wasn't the only thing looming on the horizon, however, as torrent rain and winds halted the first round of play. After the storm passed, head coach Lindsey Kuhl was tasked with riding the Jayhawk ship.
We were through, I think, 3 to 5 holes, and we played the hardest hole that day was number 4. We played it well. We played it one over with the 4 scores that we're counting at the time. So, and we knew we're good wind players. We're really good ball strikers, really good into the wind. So we knew if we just played our normal game and made a few more putts in the first day that we could be in contention.
The Jayhawks will never be out of contention with the way junior Amy Deacock is playing to start the season. Deacock shot a team-best 70 in the final round of the Bahamas tournament to propel the Jayhawks to their record-setting third straight victory. Coach Kuhl knew Deacock was special from the moment they met.
I love to coach golfers that want to play on tour, and she is that and was that, and she's gotten better and better every year because of her work ethic and her belief in herself and her game. And I think that comes a lot with, obviously, the coaching and the teaching that she's getting, but obviously the preparation. You work hard, you're going to be a confident player. She's one that can handle the pressure, that likes the pressure on her. Just a very confident player, but like you said, one of the best ball strikers we've ever been around.
Coach Kuhl's experience has taught her that championships aren't won in the fall, they're won in the spring. This year, Kuhl and the Jayhawks will approach winter break with an emphasis on the mental side of the game.
We talk a lot about what does your best performances look like and how can you control those things when you play your best, you know, how you act and behave, how you wake up in the morning, the mood, how fast or slow you do things. I think just becoming more aware of when they play their best golf.
So, what are Coach Kuhl's goals for the spring of 2025?
It's to win four or more tournaments this year. It's to make the national championship and to be the highest ranked women's golf program to come out of KU in over 50 years of the program, which is 38th right now is the highest. So our goal, you know, is those three things. Let's try and win at least one more. Let's make it to the national championship. We haven't been since 2014, and we've only been twice in our program history. And then let's have the highest ranking. So I know these girls, four seniors, are motivated to accomplish that, and I know they'll come back hungry after the winter break.
For Playmakers, I'm Chad Cushing.
Thank you, Chad and Coach. Shifting gears to KU basketball, the players may get the spotlight, but it's the managers who keep everything running smoothly. They do everything from setting up practices to game day prep and everything in between. Emma Noble sat down with manager Carson Linens to learn more.
Basketball has always been pretty much in my life. My dad, he played college basketball at a small school in Wichita. You know, there are times like I remember, first thing I did coming out of practice was going home, watching KU basketball.
The Kansas Jayhawks are one of the winningest programs in all of college men's basketball. But behind all the trophies and confetti, a team of nine individuals work day and night to keep the program a well-oiled machine. Carson Linens, a senior studying marketing at the University of Kansas, is among the nine other managers for Bill Self's team. This year, he's entering his fourth and final season managing.
When I was told that it was just kind of an option, I was like, okay, well, I would be dumb not to at least try. And then when it finally happened and I got the call, I didn't know how to function for like a week. I was like, what did I get myself into? But at the same time, it's like, what I did get myself into is going to be sweet. It's going to be awesome.
A typical day usually starts with an early wake-up call. However, with all the different tasks Carson handles on a regular basis, his schedule is always changing, making the job never boring.
Sometimes, you know, people like to shoot in the mornings, so we'll be rebounding for them if we're not at class. And so they'll do some shooting, and then around lunchtime we'll grab some food and issue out all the gear. About mid-afternoon is when practice will start. We'll be in here and just kind of wiping sweat, hanging out, making sure all the guys are good to go. Once practice is over, then we pretty much knock out the laundry and then see if there's anything else that needs to be done. And that's really a typical day in the middle of the season.
Carson works well over 40 hours a week, handling classes and homework on top of managing. The job can sometimes take a toll.
The stuff that we do isn't difficult. It's just the amount of time that we put in that can really tear some people down. I had some managers that at one point where, you know, they're like, I don't know if I can do this because of how much time it takes. You know, we try to be understanding with that, but at the same time, it takes a kind of a different kind of person to do this job.
But for Carson, the job doesn't feel like a chore. He's always had a piece of him at KU. Little did he know, it was on the court where he grew up watching games as a kid.
When I was in elementary and middle school, you know, that's all I would wear. That's all. Kansas basketball is my personality. And so being here and knowing that, you know, I'm a part of it now, I would be an idiot to leave.
For Playmakers, I'm Emma Noble.
Great stuff, Emma and Carson. Shifting from managers to players, the newcomers are ready to make their mark on this upcoming season. We touched on some of the fresh faces last week, but Lily talks about three more that will be sure to turn some heads this season.
This year's full roster brings new guys into the spotlight, so let's get to know three of them. First up is 6'1 graduate guard Shaquille Moore. Moore started his career at North Carolina State, transferred to Mississippi State for the last 3 years, and will be playing his last year of eligibility here at Kansas. Last year, he averaged just shy of 8 points per game, and was shooting nearly 47% from the field and just over 36% from three. Despite these solid stats, his offensive talent was not what brought him to KU. Moore is best known for his defensive abilities. During his junior year, Moore was named to the 2022-2023 Naismith Defensive Player of the Year watch list. Unfortunately, Moore suffered a hairline fracture to his ankle right before this year's boot camp, but is said to be cleared by October 31st, just in time for the start of KU season. Next up, we have 6'6 junior guard Rylan Griffin.
Griffin played his first two seasons at the University of Alabama and was a key piece to their historic run to the Final Four last year. He played in 36 games last season, averaging just over 11 points a game and a near 45% from the field. Griffin was second on the team and made three-pointers with 74. Griffin had impressive growth from his freshman to sophomore year. He went from averaging just over 5 points per game to just shy of 12 points in 1 year difference. If Griffin keeps trending in this direction, he's going to have a big season here with the Jayhawks. And last but not least, the most recent addition to the squad is 5'11 guard David Coit. Coit spent two seasons in the Mid-American Conference at Northern Illinois University. And in his two seasons, he became a two-time All-MAC selection. Last season at NIU, he started in all 29 games and racked up nearly 20 points a game. Coit was ranked second in the MAC and 24th nationally for points per game. He made 94 three-pointers last season for an average of 3.24 threes, ranking him 10th in the nation. Coit's scoring potential makes him another great addition to this year's lineup. Big 12 Media Days took place earlier this week, and Courtney Poston was in attendance. Courtney, how is KU basketball looking a week before their home opener?
Kansas men's basketball arrived to Big 12 Media Day ranked number one in the AP preseason poll. Head coach Bill Self made it clear that with the injection of four new schools to the conference, his confidence stays the same.
And the expectations are high, and I think the expectations may be actually undersold a bit, because I think there's actually more great teams in our league than maybe what people are talking about. But I'm excited about my group. I think we're better. I think we've got a better roster. I think we're deeper.
Speaking of new additions, Women's Hoops welcomes eight new faces, including North Dakota transfer Elle Evans. After her time spent in the transfer portal, she ultimately landed on Kansas and spoke passionately on why she chose Lawrence to call home.
I think it's a lot of things. This really just checked my boxes out of the portal for really everything that I was looking for. Being a lot closer to home, I think, was one of the big things, but also just the relationships. I kind of knew the second I got on campus for my visit that, you know, you kind of get that vibe. Also just the girls, even on my visit, and then now that I've been here for a while, I think that that's really kind of made my choice, and I've been very happy with my choice, and it's been better than I've expected. So I think all those things led me to be at Kansas, and obviously I'm super glad I did.
For Playmakers, I'm Courtney Poston.
Lots of good basketball coming up soon. The men's team will be in Arkansas tonight at 8 p.m. as they will play the Razorbacks in their first exhibition game. For live updates, be sure to follow our socials at PlaymakersKU. Before we tip off basketball season, we have another big game coming up this weekend on the football field. The Jayhawks will be in Manhattan, Kansas to take on the K-State Wildcats in the Sunflower Showdown. Lily Hennick is here to preview this heated rivalry.
The Sunflower Showdown, a rivalry rooted in history, competition, hatred, and shared passion. If you ask Jayhawk fans, they will tell you that they have 65 wins, while Wildcat fans say they will have the number of 64 wins. That is because in 1980, the Big 8 Conference ordered Kansas to forfeit the result of their game with K-State due to an ineligible player. However, either way, Kansas still remains on top of the all-time record against the Purple Foes. As college football heats up in Week 9, this long-stemmed rivalry is set to take center stage in Manhattan, where the Jayhawks have started the season 1-3 in conference play. However, each game was decided of by an average of 6.3 points. The Jayhawks rebounded with their first league win last weekend after dominating Houston. The Wildcats have won three straight Big 12 games since losing their first conference matchup against BYU and have scored over 40 points in two of those matchups. Kansas State's Avery Johnson is one of seven FBS quarterbacks with at least 1,400 passing yards and 300 rushing yards this season. Meanwhile, the Wildcats rank fifth in FBS rushing defense, allowing 83 rushing yards per game. For the Jayhawks, Jalen Daniels is one of eight FBS quarterbacks with at least 500 passing yards and no interceptions in October. Running back Devin Neal starts the season with 117 carries for 692 yards and 7 touchdowns. Neal is just 73 yards shy from becoming KU's all-time leader after tying two program records last weekend. Shifting defensively, cornerback Kobe Bryant is coming off of a career outing against Houston, marking the fourth time a Kansas player recorded three interceptions in a game. After early season struggles, the Jayhawks have potential to surprise, especially against a K-State team that may be feeling the pressure of its ranking as a number 16 team in the nation and a 10.5-point favorite. The Sunflower Showdown is set to take place tomorrow at Bill Snyder Family Stadium at 7 p.m. on ESPN2, with playmakers on the road to keep you up to date on this action-packed rivalry game. Let's head back over to Emma to see what else is in store for us today, because like KU football, we are just getting started.
It's going to be a big weekend for Kansas football. Don't go anywhere, because after the break, we have updates on the WNBA Finals, a look at this year's World Series matchup, and more.
You may not hear it at first, but it's there. Our chant, rising. On this summit, callings converge. Voices unify into a chorus. Sounds out for good. For greatness. Can you hear it?
As of this morning, Tua Tagovailoa, quarterback for the Miami Dolphins, has now cleared the NFL-mandated concussion protocol and will start Sunday's game versus the Cardinals, announced by head coach Mike McDaniel. In other NFL news, the Kansas City Chiefs finalized their trade deal for Tennessee Titans wide receiver DeAndre Hopkins. The 32-year-old joins Kansas City in exchange for a conditional fifth-round draft pick, which can become a fourth-rounder if the Chiefs reach the Super Bowl and Hopkins plays 60% of the team's offensive snaps. In a recent interview, Hopkins was asked what it means to join the Chiefs. He said, quote, "I haven't played meaningful football in a couple of years." With recent injuries around the Chiefs' offense, Hopkins will be a crucial addition to the roster. The WNBA Finals was quite a thrilling series. In overtime of Game 5, the New York Liberty defeated the Minnesota Lynx, marking the first time the team is WNBA champions. Kara Lyons has more.
The WNBA season came to a close this past Sunday with the New York Liberty taking it all. The Game 5 matchup between the Liberty and Minnesota Lynx drew in the highest viewership in 25 years with 3.3 million views. This year has been nothing short of an exciting season for the women with everything that went down, like the battle between Caitlin Clark and Angel Reese, players speaking out about the toxic environment within the league, and more recently, a controversial call that might have just cost the Lynx a championship, according to many fans and head coach Cheryl Reeves. All of these emotions leave WNBA fans wondering, what happens from here? First up, there had been rumors that Reese would be leaving the league, and who could blame her with the amount of fallout that happened throughout the season? Turns out the rumors were simply just that. Reese came out and said that she will be participating in the unrivaled 3-on-3 league founded by Breonna Stewart and Nafisa Collier. This new league will consist of the top 30 players in the WNBA and is set to tip off in Miami in January of 2025. 26 of the athletes have been named so far, and the last four look to be announced later this year. Reese stated in an interview that she is looking forward to this opportunity as she had no desire to play overseas during the offseason. Before fans can get excited about this new summer league, they will be on the edge of their seat waiting to hear what team will win the draft lottery. We are just a month out from knowing who has the number one draft pick, which means we will have a good idea of where number one draft pick and NCAA star Paige Beckers will be headed following her last year at UConn. If you didn't get enough of the finals excitement, don't you worry. We're trading our sneakers for cleats, and Barry's going to give us the dirt on everything going on in this year's World Series matchup.
Strap those cleats up, because this World Series will be one for the books. The Los Angeles Dodgers faced the New York Yankees for the 12th time in MLB history. Let's rewind to Game 5 of the ALCS, where Yankees outfielder Juan Soto crushed a 3-run homer in the 10th inning of Game 5 to secure New York's spot in the World Series. You can see a lot of Yankees fans celebrating and crying tears of joy all over social media after their 15-year drought. The Los Angeles Dodgers also taking care of business in the NLCS after beating the New York Mets in 6 games. Now, if you're a Dodgers fan, how cool would it be to take down both New York teams in the playoffs? Now, despite everything said about these teams and their recent successes, let's talk about something more important, their markets. Los Angeles and New York both bring in a lot of money, from inside the ballparks to the city alone, and it all starts from the populations of both these big cities. The Yankees are the most valuable team at $7.6 billion, and the Dodgers with the second best at $5.5 billion. Why is this important? Well, in order for both teams to see the World Series game and the success up until this point, it took a little bit of money. A lot of people have hatred towards both of these teams, and that's because they probably grabbed your favorite player off your team. The Dodgers would go on to trade for Mookie Betts in 2020 and then sign him for 12 years worth $365 million. They would then go on to get Freddie Freeman 2 years later for $162 million, followed by Tyler Glasnow for 4 years for $136 million. Also, catcher Will Smith for 10 years and $140 million contract. We haven't even mentioned the fact that the Dodgers spent $1 billion on two of their players alone before the season started. Who are they getting this money from? I don't know, and it's none of my business. The Yankees also pay their players a lot of money. They are trying to sign a big contract for Juan Soto after the season, given his recent performance. As you can see, both teams hold their players to a high standard, but we wouldn't know what the outcome would be if there was a salary cap. Both of these teams having big markets are taking advantage of no salary cap. Pay to win is a big thing in baseball. Seeing this series will be like an intense all-star game. This series will begin tonight at 7:08 p.m. Central on Fox. Whichever teams win, you can thank the owners for putting a great team together. Because in the words of Euripides, money talks. Hey, Jack Jackson, money goes a long way. So show us what Jaden Daniels' money worth.
Good job, Barry. I think the Dodgers are going to win this World Series. What's up, guys? My name's Jack Jackson, and welcome back to NFL Breakdown. We're going to be talking about Jaden Daniels, the rookie out of LSU, quarterback for the Commanders. So a couple weeks ago, he played the Bengals on Monday night, and we're going to see right here. Watch this end. They do a great job of using Daniels' legs to score touchdowns. He's going to crash, and Daniels is going to pull this ball on a read option. And just watch this. Wide open. Untouched into the end zone. And we're actually going to get a good back angle of this play. And you'll see right here. So Daniels, this is his read right here, this defensive end. He's going to bite on this fake with his running back, and that's telling Daniels to keep the ball. And so Daniels sees that, pulls it, untouched touchdown. Now we're going to see later in this game right here, there's about 2 minutes left, this guy right here, number 22, is going to come untouched. And so Daniels knows right now that he has man-to-man between this guy and his man, Terry McLaurin, and You're liking that matchup any day of the week. So Daniel sees this. He's going to stay in there, take a hit, deliver the throw, and it's a perfect throw for a touchdown. Commanders go on to win that game. Now, here's an interesting defense that not many teams run, and the Arizona Cardinals run this. This side of the field is going to be playing man, or going to be playing zone, and these two guys are going to be manned up with these two guys. Now, what's a great way to beat man? You got these things called man beaters in the red zone, and those are posts. They're going to run this post, which this guy's going to take, leaving this area of the field wide open for Terry McLaurin to come behind him with a second post. Watch this. Right there, post, DB goes, Terry McLaurin throws, wide open because that safety left the area, touchdown Commanders. Jaden Daniels has a great start to the season, and if he keeps playing like this, he's going to win Rookie of the Year. But as of right now, Dan Quinn saying he's week to week with that rib injury. So let's hope that he's okay and can continue to play like he has been playing. Emma, back to you.
After the break, we have some more content coming your way, including top five plays of the week, mic'd up, and more.
From adversity, we rose. We made history and became pioneers, voyagers, champions, Jayhawks. And when our chant rises, haunting and hallowed, Jayhawks are telling the world what's near. Victory.
There's never a dull moment in the sports world. With action all across the board from football to basketball and everything in between, Charlie has picked out his top five plays of the week. Charlie, who were some of the biggest playmakers this past week?
Well, Emma, we had a lot of good plays this week. We're just going to jump straight into it. Coming in at number five, you have the Chiefs versus the Niners. You have Patrick Mahomes going against, right here, we have Chiefs Niners, number five. You've seen this plenty of times before. Mahomes goes into the end zone, boom! That's Malik Mustafa, the rookie out of Wake Forest. Ow. You know, I hope he likes the way... Oh, grass taste. That is not good. Number four, we got LeBron James. Oh, rack attack. He's 39! 39 years old. Taking home the W, carrying the Lakers. 110-103 win for Los Angeles. Number three, haven't seen this one probably. Army-Navy women's soccer, Kalen Brady. Great footwork. Top right corner. Are you kidding me? What a shot from Kalen Brady. That shot put him up 2-0. They end up winning it 4-0. They're 10-4-1 overall, 4-2-1 in conference. They play Colgate tomorrow. Just great stuff. We'll look at it one more time. Wow. Number two, we're in Edmonton. It's the Canes versus the Oilers. Sebastian Aho in overtime. 2-2, not a lot of time with backhand from Gostisbehere. Great pass, not as good as this. Wow, a one-timer from Sebastian Aho. Stuart Skinner cannot believe it, the goalie for the Oilers, as Carolina goes into the reigning Western Conference champs. House comes out victorious. 4-2 on the year are the Hurricanes. One more look at it. Oh, that's gross. Sebastian Aho goes bar down for the win. 3-2 win for the Hurricanes. Number one, can't beat it. Juan Soto, Yankees, Guardians. We've seen this story before. Does it have the juice? It does. Yankees win it 5-2. 3-5. Juan Soto goes 3-for-5 with a home run and RBIs. Hunter Gaddis, the pitcher who gave up the home run, had a 1.57 ERA in the regular season, but that entire Guardians bullpen just really struggled in the playoffs. Up and away, Juan Soto goes dead center. Leaves the yard, sends the Yankees back to the World Series. That's going to be a Dodgers versus Yankees World Series, which starts tonight. A lot of good plays this week. Emma, which one was your favorite?
Charlie, I think you nailed it. Nothing beats a game-winning home run. The NBA season is in full swing, and there's plenty to discuss. Jackson, Carson, and Luke, what are we to expect this season?
Welcome back to Roundtable with Reed, and officially the NBA season has started. I've got Carson Shea and Luke Martin, and we are going to talk some sleeper teams and some teams to win the NBA title. Now, let's start with a quick preface. You are a Thunder fan, you are a Nuggets fan, and I am a Bucks fan. We are keeping those off the list entirely, except maybe a little surprise later, but you're not allowed to talk about your favorite team. That's what we're getting at here. You got to be a little more creative than that. Carson, let's start with you. A favorite to win the title, you're taking the New York Knicks, but why?
I know they did not look good on Tuesday night, but I still have the Knicks as my favorite. I mean, Jalen Brunson already took a massive leap last year, and I think he could be the best player in the East if Joel Embiid sits out all these games. I think he could be the best player in the East and have a case for MVP. And look at the roster that they just built. They're specifically built to take down the Celtics. I know it didn't work out on Tuesday night, but I'm telling you, in a seven-game series, I got the Knicks going all the way in the East.
Very interesting. Now over to Luke, another team that kind of caught the attention of the national eye last year, and that was the Minnesota Timberwolves. You have them to win the title this year. Tell me why.
That's right. I'm putting my faith in Ant-Man this year. No doubt he's shown what he's capable of last season. A little underwhelming performance in the playoffs from Carl Anthony Towns. We switched that out.
That's not a problem anymore. That's not a problem. There you go.
I think he's going to boost the perimeter shooting, hopefully boost that offense up a little bit more. Mm-hmm. And I just think they're a really strong team. Didn't really get what they were looking for last year, but I think they can turn it around for sure.
And then so my pick to win the NBA Finals, I told you we might have to circle back to someone's favorite team. I'm going to your favorite team, the Oklahoma City Thunder. I just love the way this team is built. And the one knock on them last year was they don't have experience. They don't have the... You know, I don't want to say mental toughness because I don't know if that's necessarily true, but maybe they weren't built with experience because they were all super young. This year, they're all back. It's the same team that I think – I love the way their team is built. I love the way Chet Holmgren is your kind of your stout five-man, but you've got just an all-time player in Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. He's awesome. Everyone loves to watch him. I'm really excited about the Thunder this year. I think they've got the guns to go all the way. Now, a sleeper team, maybe we don't think they're going to go all the way, but Carson, you're taking the Houston Rockets, a team that I also really do like, but I'll let you talk about it.
I mean, they were on the outside looking in last year in the play-in. They were the 11 seed. They just missed the play-in, and I honestly think they have a roster that could be really fun. I don't know if they're going to get into the playoffs without having to get through the play-in, but I think that they're a sleeper team for sure. I mean, Alperen Şengün is so good. I mean, if anyone's comparable to Nikola Jokic in this league, I'd say it's him. I think
had
he's
to mention
great.
Nikola Jokic
I had to
once.
Put him in there once.
Had to mention
I had
him
to.
Once.
I had to.
No, but you're right, though. He can really shoot the ball.
He can. And Jalen Green is so fun to watch. I think he's one of the most fun young players in this league. Mm-hmm. I mean, Fred VanVleet, no matter what you think about him, he can be a dog at times. So I think this roster can take them pretty far into the West.
Now I'll go over to you, Luke. Your sleeper team is the Sacramento Kings, a team that's kind of experienced some highs and lows. They were really good for a couple of years there, and of course they've been bad for forever up until that point. This year, we probably think they're going to be on the outside looking in, but what makes you think they've got a chance to make a little run into the playoffs?
Well, the Kings have always been a really high-scoring, kind of explosive, fast-paced sort of offense. We have De'Aaron Fox, one of the fastest players probably on the court on any given night. Mm-hmm. Now they have DeMar DeRozan on the floor, who's going to build up that kind of veteran leadership on the team, kind of build up some of those young guys. We still have Domantas Sabonis, who is nothing short of a great center on the floor. And they didn't get what they were looking for, but I think if given a good playoff run this year, we could see them potentially be the next sleeper pick.
I kind of like that with the Kings, but I'm going to push that same pushback with the Charlotte Hornets. And this team is all score. This team is no defense. This team is all score. I really do like Brandon Miller out of Alabama. Obviously, maybe not the rookie season that he expected to have. But then again, he was still pretty decent last year. And, of course, you got LaMelo Ball. And that's the key for this team, is if LaMelo Ball can stay healthy, I think the Hornets can really make a run. Maybe not, like, to a Eastern Conference Finals. But they could play a spoiler to somebody like the Bucks, like the Sixers, like somebody like that. I think the Charlotte Hornets could definitely make a play there. Now, we talked our sleeper teams. Wonder what Emma Hale has. Emma, who's your sleeper team in the NBA coming up this season?
You know, Reed, my sleeper team is the Orlando Magic. They have a young, dynamic roster with guys like Vancaro and Wagner, and I can see them making a run in the Eastern Conference. But let me tell you who's not a sleeper team, your Playmakers Flag football team, who is semifinal bound. Let's head over to the fields.
What's up, Playmakers? Welcome back to Mic'd Up. This time, it's football. And usually I'm behind the camera, but now I'm in front of the camera. So let's get after it. I think the ref just barked at me.
Are you mic'd up?
Yeah.
That's so funny. I literally looked at this.
Yeah. Yeah, no. Just some random piece that I like to have on me. It's like my good luck charm or something. Oh my God, we bring the new dimension. Costco guys. Oh, that was a fire. Is that Ralph? Thank you. Oh! That's okay. Lauren Rich on the move. She has a concussion. It's all right. I like the effort. That's okay. Hey, hand-eye coordination is not there. That's okay. She has a concussion. You are? Oh, thank you. Are they actually? Dude, the abs are up too. He's updating me on the abs game. This is massive. Shout out to this guy. It's third down. I'm in the flat. I did that on purpose. Just stop.
Can you find an
I know,
open
but I don't
area,
know who's
stop.
Behind me. I mean,
the screen stop.
No.
Lily, stop.
Stop. Oh, he's gonna rush. You got him. Oh. Hey, that's okay. That's a first down and more. That's a first down and more. Run the ball. Run the ball. He's dicing him up all the way. How's it? Chad, I'm wide open in the end zone. That's okay. That's a touchdown. Oh, cradle the baby.
You okay?
Reed.
You good?
Hey, Reed. No, I'm not catching you.
Oh, yeah.
Go. Run, Chad. Dice up the defense. That's okay. That's a first down. He's on Chad. I gotta duck. I ducked as if I'm not sure. Oh, go, Chad. Chad to the. Oh! Run it downfield. Heads up. Jackson Reed for the interception! That's my all time, all American safety. This was the first round of playoffs. We have another round, and then championship is in sight. So we'll head back to the drawing book for next week, and we'll be back.
That's all for this week's edition of Playmakers. Be sure to follow us on social media at PlaymakersKU to find all our content on the sports world as we see it. Stay tuned for Run It Back on Mondays at 1 p.m. for all the game results happening over the weekend, and Good Morning KU Sports on Friday mornings at 10:30 for more sports talk. And remember, it's not about the game you played, but the plays you made. Rock chalk, and see you next time.